Yeah. All right. Good evening.
Good evening.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Sorry for my late arrival. I'll say my hellos when I'm saying my goodbyes. So I want to talk to you tonight about some things the Lord put in my heart, more so this morning than the past few days. I've kind of been hearing some of these things and some things that have happened in the past few days that he impressed this upon my heart very heavily. So I want to share this with you. And I want to start by reading from 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 10. And I'm going to read you from the Amplified Translation. Therefore, humble yourselves, demote, lower yourselves in your own estimation under the mighty hand of God, that in due time he may exalt you, casting the whole of your care, all your anxieties, all your worries, all your concerns, once and for all, listen to that, once and for all, on him, for he cares for you affectionately and cares about you watchfully. Be well balanced, temperate, sober of mind. Be vigilant and cautious at all times. For that enemy of yours, see how it says, it doesn't say for the enemy, that enemy of yours makes that distinction there. The devil roams around like a lion roaring in fierce hunger, seeking someone to seize upon and devour. Withstand him, be firm in faith against his onset, rooted, established, strong, immovable, and determined, knowing that the same identical sufferings are appointed to your brotherhood, the whole body of Christians throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who imparts all blessing and favor, who has called you to his own eternal glory in Christ Jesus, will himself complete and make you what you ought to be, establish and ground you securely, and strengthen you and settle you. So it shouldn't be shocking to you that there's someone else in this world that is going through the same thing that you are. Because although we are unique, we're also the same. Mm-hmm. Everybody goes through heartbreak. Everybody goes through financial difficulties. Everybody goes through the loss of a loved one. Whatever can happen to a person in this world can happen to every single person in this world. Mm-hmm. So we've talked before in the past few days, few services, about coming together, you know, unity of the Spirit. And that led me to James chapter 5, verse 16. From now on, I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. It says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. So James is in here, confess your sins to one another. Pray for one another. You know, it's nice to us as a believer go to another Christian and say, would you pray for me? I have a need. Or someone come to us and say, would you pray for me? Because I have a need. So we need not only to confess our sins or pray for one another to come in unity of the Spirit, but we also need to share with one another what God has done for us. It's very important as well, not only to ask people to pray for something that's burdening us, but also let's share what's good God has done mm-hmm. for us in our lives. So the reason we do this is not only so that we overcome by the word of our testimony, but so that others can be reminded of what the Lord can do for them. And we can all use that testimony as reassurance that our faith in Jesus Christ is not in vain. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 35 and 36. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what is promised. Let's continue to believe and trust in the Lord, because the reward is good. You know, we should stay focused on Him, regardless of what's going on around us, so we know that we're going to receive what He said He's going to give us.
Amen.
Hebrews 10, verses 23 to 25. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for He who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Let me read that again. Verse 24, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, the encouragement of sharing the good things that God has done for us. Mm-hmm. Not neglecting to meet together, as we're doing right now, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Going back to James chapter 5, it says, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another. I added, let's share the good things that the Lord has done for us. Mm-hmm. It says it right here, encouraging one another. When you share the good things that the Lord has done for you, you're encouraging the other person
sure.
to trust God, because what He promised that person is going to come. So, with all this, you know, the Bible also says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. So Joshua chapter 1, verse 9 says, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. I don't know if you remember, a few weeks ago, I talked about how, you know, the Lord lead us, and wherever we go, we release His fragrance. So it's saying right here, you know, this is also confirmation that because of that, it's proof that wherever we go, there He is.
Mm-hmm.
So I've been thinking about this, and I've been meditating. You know, why are you putting this in my heart, Lord? Well, Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 says, every word of God proves true. So we trust Him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, who do we believe? Well, we believe Him. We believe His word,
Amen.
And if we believe His word, we know everything is okay.
Amen.
So that led me to 2 Kings chapter 4, and I'm going to read verses 25 and 26. We all know the story of the Shunammite woman, but it says, so she set out and came to the man of God at Mount Carmel. When the man of God saw her coming, he said to Gehazi, his servant, look, there's the Shunammite. Verse 26, run at once to meet her and say to her, is all well with you? Is all well with your husband? Is all well with the child? In this life, we're going to face many situations. We're going to be asked many questions. And those questions can be these questions that we just saw in the scripture.
Mm-hmm.
So let me read verse 26 again. Run at once to meet her and say to her, is all well with you? Is all well with your husband? Is all well with the child? Now notice what she answers, and this is upon what her miracle hinges. She answered, all is well.
Mm-hmm.
We speak the word of God, not only to ourselves or to our lives, but to others as well.
Mm-hmm.
We speak the word of God to our circumstances. Why? Because we need our words to go before us.
Yeah.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 17 says, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pastor said here before, he was talking about the sword. We have to swing that sword, because if we don't move it, if we don't use it, it's not going to do anything. In order for us to wield that sword, which is the word of God, we need to let it produce its results in us. We need to let it nourish us.
Mm-hmm.
So that led me to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. And He humbled you and led you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that He might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. This is the first time that I have seen this in the Bible other than the New Testament. So I continue to learn, just good. And this is the same thing that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. And who did he say that to? He told that to the devil himself. So the devil has already been warned of the power of God's word. Yet, he still continues to try and make us believe that the word of God is faulty, powerless, untruthful. And he's been doing so since the beginning of time. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? We need to be very careful before we open our mouths, because the devil will try to use our own words against us by twisting around God's word. There's a saying that goes, you have two ears and one mouth, and you should use them in that proportion. Yeah. Some people might laugh and think this is funny, which it is. But what they don't realize is that they're actually quoting scripture. And that is James chapter 1, verse 19. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. We are soldiers. We put the whole armor of God. We are trained, and our training is the revelation that we receive through the Holy Spirit when our minds are renewed, when we hear the word of God. So let's continue to eat that word.
Yes.
Let it be nourishment for your spirit so that you are ready to destroy the attacks of the devil, not only to you, but to others as well.
Yeah.
And I want to finish with this. Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And he said to me, son of man, eat whatever you find here. Eat this scroll and go speak to the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he gave me the scroll to eat. And he said to me, son of man, feed your belly with this scroll that I give you, and fill your stomach with it. Then I ate it, and it was in my mouth as sweet as honey.
Yes.
And he said to me, And he said to me, son of man, go to the house of Israel and speak my words to them.
Yes.
That is our instruction. That is our action. So that's what we must do.
Yes.
All right. I'm excited.
Yeah.
Anyone has any prayer requests or testimonies that they would like to share? Yes, Dean.
I don't talk about this too often, but I did some pretty serious self-inflicted damage to my heart with my lifestyle, and I just went to the doctor Monday. At one time, it was working at left side, 22% of its capabilities. God didn't say, you did this to yourself, you're on your own. I'm healing good.
Yes.
It's like 80% now.
Amen.
I'm going back every week, then 2 weeks now. I don't have to go back for 2 months.
Good. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Good.
It's moving.
It's awesome.
Anyone else? Tim.
Yes, want to thank the Lord. It's refreshing time sometime in the morning, driving to work. And today it just seemed like I listened to the Christian radio, and it was just songs that was all in a row about praising Him, turning eyes on Jesus. I'd rather have Jesus more than anything. And all those songs just got me thinking how good God is,
Amen.
And that you Yeah. If you say you're a Christian and you're out doing all this other stuff, you know, like, well, I don't think you're serious. I don't think you're serious. No, it doesn't mean we're perfect people, we make mistakes. But when you put God first, there's a light that comes through you.
Yes.
And people are drawn to that. Yeah. Why are you acting so different? Let me tell you. Because we talk about Peter, always have a reason. You know, you got a reason. You know, people look at you and they look at that hope in you. Why do you have hope in your life? Because the hope comes in Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen.
That's right.
God.
Amen. I was taking care of some other stuff on the roof, and I just thank God for protection in that situation, because it got ugly real fast.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So, thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Cindy's here. She's doing good.
And
just praise the Lord for answered prayers and the healing power.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. I mean, I have worked at the post office for 16 years, and it was the first time I was on the verge of tears and ready to just say, I'm done, and leave. I had people swearing at me, throwing their mailboxes on the counter. It was just one bizarre thing after another and horrible thing after another. And I prayed on my lunch hour that day because, you know, I was thinking about how my day had gone. I was like ready to go. I can't do this anymore. And so I prayed, and the rest of the day was a little better. This morning, on Wednesdays, I'm on the window dealing with the public all day. And this Wednesday, not only was a girl on vacation, but I knew I was going to be on the window again, blah, blah, blah. But on my way to work, I just started confessing all the things that I know, who I am, and I have the authority. So if I'm at the counter and I'm helping the customers in the lobby, they will see Jesus in me. They will feel his love. They will be polite. They will, I mean, you know, I have authority mm-hmm.
everywhere that I go.
Yeah.
And today was night and day compared to last Wednesday. Now, am I any different? No. But I opened my mouth and I confessed what I know.
Yes.
And it doesn't, I mean, we can know a lot of things, but until we open our mouth and start standing on it,
right,
sometimes
right.
it doesn't happen.
Yeah. That's right.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
So I thank the Lord for
yeah.
a great
yeah.
day.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Anyone else? Yes.
I just want to thank God. He's always good. I'm over by Nebraska, over to Burlington, but Illinois, and you know, I want to be crabby, tired, but I'm not. I'm encouraged because when I go, the Lord just encourages me to pray for these cities, to pray for these towns, to pray for these people, and I feel like His
Yes, Sheila.
Mine's always prayer requests. That's what I get bombarded with, okay. Just because mom is having some issues and going to have to go to Mayo Clinic, her name is Phyllis. So sort of we pray for her. My friend Karen starts chemotherapy on Friday. Just pray that she, this works for her body, no nausea, no bad side effects. Janine came over yesterday, and she's going through some things with her grandson who ran away from a facility and was on the run for several days. Finally, he showed up at her door on Saturday, but they don't know what's going to happen. It's like Eldora, which is a lockdown, or back to this facility that's leaves the door wide open for him. So Devontae, he's going to be 18 in October, and if he doesn't get straightened out, he's going to have really harsh punishments come after that, and she's just wiped out. So I'm sort of pray about that, too.
Amen.
What's coming up?
Thank you, God. I got somebody supposed to come also, Mary Kate, that was going to diverticulitis here. She is also, is in remission from cancer, but still has to go see me. But she wants to come Friday night. So she says if she feels like it after going to the doctor on Friday, she'd like to be able to come and get a word from God for her life. Yep. Even if you're 83 years old, you know, the Lord still has a word for you.
That's right. Amen.
Amen. Okay, well, let's stand. Let's stand the Lord on this beautiful day. Father, thank you for bringing us here in your presence. Thank you, Father, for giving us your word. A word, Lord, that we can use to go out into this world wielding it like a sword to rebuke all of the attacks of the enemy that is bringing against us and against those that are around us that ask for our prayers so that we can come together in unity of the Spirit. Heavenly Father, with these words that you give us, we also declare what you have called us. You have called us your righteousness in Jesus Christ. You have called us healed. You have called us your children, Lord. We declare that everything that you have said that is going to come to pass in our lives right now, we're claiming it in the name of the mighty Jesus Christ. Father, we lift the needs of all of those that are in need of healing, restoration, financial breakthrough, relationships that leads to man, Lord. Right now, we declare, Lord, that in the name of Jesus, the manifestation of all of those miracles, those needs is taking place right now. For you are faithful, Lord, and you promise everything that you tell us that you will do for us. I pray, Lord, that whatever message you are delivering in this church that you are revealing to us, that goes out this building, through those doors, and gets spread through this city, through this neighborhood, through this state, through this whole nation. Lord, give your revelation to our leaders so that they are reminded that you are the center of our lives. That with our trust in you, Lord, you are going to direct our steps. And we know that all is well, Father. Thank you for choosing us to be instruments of you, to go out into this world and share your light. Shine your light onto others so they can see. I'm very grateful for everything that God has done for me. And how starting this relationship with Him has made me into the person that I am today. You know, sometimes the me from the past tries to come out. I'm like, it's not gonna happen. But I'm just so grateful that I have the strength to control those things and continue to grow and be an encouragement to others for everything He's done for me, and also for others to encourage me, because I'm encouraged every time that you guys speak and share
yes.
things, and,
yeah.
and I love it.
Yeah. Amen.
So, just want to say thanks.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Announcement, Tom Stammen will be here this Friday. You're still won't be here, right?
I will be.
You will be? Okay. What? Actually, not so much. I'm more confident now in my abilities. Anyway, let's speak the word. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Grandpa Juan, would you mind? We changed the title. It's no longer brothers. Grandpa. I'm kidding, John. We love you.
Grandpa Juan.
Lord Jesus, we give you the glory, Lord, praise, and just thank you, Lord, for things that we don't even know, Lord God. We just are so blessed of you, we can't comprehend it, but we just give you the praise. God, help us to worship you fervently tonight, Lord God. Lift you up for your worthy and for this offering, God, and pray for it.
Yes.
And your blessing upon it, and people will forgive, and all to the glory of Jesus. Amen.
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 I need a confirmation, don't
when you're talking about trees, I was thinking microphone stand, so. Hallelujah. Is that James?
I want to share something that my mom sent me this morning, but
go ahead.
I gotta translate on the fly, so bear with me. this is the good thing about being bilingual. This is something she highlighted on a book that she's reading right now. She sent it to me, and she's like, "Being intercessors, we have to cover the person or the situation in prayer. It is God's job to convict, sin, and heal. There will be situations that we will face that who has sinned, but only after having soaked the situation in prayer. So, I don't know. Just wanted to share that.
That's good. That's good. Yeah. Thank you. That's good.
It's a book she's reading about intercessory prayer.
That's so. It. There it is. Mm-hmm. There it is. We've been there for the last week.
Thank you.
Time, show us your glory, Lord.
Show us your glory. Show us your glory. Show us your glory.
Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Lord, we are so desperate for your presence. Lord, years ago you asked us to press in to even the past revivals, Lord. The word press, Lord, to press in. And Lord, when you released your presence, Lord, as we pressed in, you left an impression in us, Lord.
Yes.
You left an impression in us, Lord. When revival waned, Lord, the impression was still left in us. And Lord, as I stand in the gap for brothers and sisters who were so impressed by your last move, Lord, that impression you left an impression, and that impression is empty, and it left a depression. It left a depression, Lord. Lord, show us your glory. Help us to press in. Help us to press back in, Lord. Help us to press back in. For you are the author and the finisher of our faith, Lord. And your mercies are new every morning, Lord. We glorify and magnify your name.
Your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, farther than I can see. Your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, farther than I can see. I reach for you when I'm going under. I wait for you, Jesus, you're my lifeline. Your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, the farther than I can see. Lord, your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, the farther than I can see. Lord, it reach for you when I'm going under. I wait for you, Jesus, you're my lifeline. 'Cause where could I go? Where could I stand? And how could I leave the shelter of your hand? Oh, where could I go? Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Your mercy goes much deeper. The grace that rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, farther than I can see. Lord, your mercy goes much deeper. Your grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, farther than I can see. Where could I go? Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Lord, where could I go? Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Lord, where could I go? Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Lord, where could I go? Where could I stand? How could I leave the shelter of your hand? Your mercy goes much deeper. Grace, it rescues me. Your mercy goes much deeper, farther than I can see. Farther than I can see. Farther than I can see.
ourselves, amen. And hopefully the Lord will finish that. I don't want to be left with the ending. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'll leave that up to him. Hallelujah. I just want to say something that I think is, I believe it's the truth. Hallelujah. And I understand exactly what Mike is saying, and all of us have experienced those situations where we've been in really intense kind of revivals or meetings or what have you, where the Lord has really ministered to us. But I really do believe, and I'm not saying this as a cop-out, because nobody has been any more over the years intense when it comes to revival and that type of thing. But I really think God wants to do a new thing.
Yes.
And we're longing for things that are over.
Yeah.
If that's the problem, we need to move on, because right. God is not the God of 20 years ago or 10 years ago or 5 years ago.
Exactly.
He wants to do something new. And the more I look at the scripture, I think of the revivals that I was involved in Texas and different places where we were, and Louisiana and around. I wasn't in Brownsville. I wasn't in Toronto, but I've been in some things where God was really moving and had a lot of emotions and so forth.
Right.
But that's what a lot of it is. And we are supposed to be the body of Christ. At some point, we need to start grow up and ministering rather than going expecting to be ministered to all the time. You know, which is what revivals basically are. They're trying to revive the saints. My God, how many revivals do we need before we wake up to the fact that we're supposed to be doing this? You know, this is what we're called to do. I think it's too self-centered and self-conscious to always go expecting that somehow I'm going to get the good goosebumps today instead of you being the ministry that's reaching out to minister to somebody else. We diminish what God wants to do because it becomes all about us. You don't ever see Jesus. Now, are we not the body of Christ? Are we not brothers and sisters in the Lord? We are to be Christ in this world. Well, if we are, I don't ever see Jesus being ministered to other than by angels and by the Father, you know? So at some point, we need to grow up and take our position in the body and start ministering and see, because here's the deal. The more you, and every one of you know this because you've all ministered somehow, some way, somewhere in different situations. Every one of you know you cannot do that without being blessed. You get blessed. You cannot be a conduit for the Holy Spirit to move through without being impacted by that. We're trying to get it the other way. We're like little kids, always wanting to be pampered, you know, always wanting it to be about us. And Jesus is saying, come on, at some point you've got to start getting out there and touching other people's lives instead of sitting around being depressed because you're not getting goosebumps or you're not, you know what I'm saying? I don't know. A lot of us come out of Pentecostal backgrounds, or several of us at least have, and I won't ask you who or why or whatever. But that was my foundation in terms of salvation. I went to church as a kid in Bible school, but it was just a very fundamental, typical kind of, you know, bland Christian, but no real salvation message, no real, you know, ministry to speak of. But Pentecostals, God bless them, and I thank the Lord for them, or I wouldn't have got saved. I needed something pretty intense, you know what I'm saying? And I got it. But the thing is, what I've learned over the years, Pentecostalism is so much about our emotions, so much about our feelings. And we all, God knows we've got feelings, and it's okay to feel them. And we do. I mean, we weep sometimes, we laugh sometimes, we get into the spirit, and those things happen. But the problem is, it has a tendency to suck you into it always being about emotion. So if you're not feeling something, then you get down or depressed or whatever. I mean, we don't have to feel anything. We have the Holy Spirit. We have God with us, right?
Yes.
And so, you know, I think sometimes I need to renew my mind and
yes.
You know, re-identify myself in Christ, but not a revival. I mean, you know, if you understand what I'm saying, I'm not against revival, but I just really think God wants reformation. He wants the church to move and not just constantly being on their last leg,
right.
happen to be revived again, while all around us the world is lost and going to hell, and we're wanting another shout.
Yeah.
You know, we're just wanting to feel something.
Sure.
And God's saying, look, this is about faith. That is not faith, in spite of what people may try to tell you. It isn't faith if you've got to feel something to prove to you that God is with you and that God is moving. Did he not say he'd never leave us or forsake us? Now, he's always been with us. And if he's been with me, I don't need any reviving. I just need to be aware of the God that is in me, that is with me, that wants to do what he always has done. He hasn't gone anywhere. He didn't go anywhere after Brownsville. He didn't go anywhere after Toronto. He didn't go anywhere after Azusa Street. He's still right here with us. Well, if I want that to be expressed, then I need to be doing something to release the Holy Spirit. Am I right? So I get it. I mean, I understand why people get, you know, nostalgic and, you know, focused on those things. But it's really counterproductive for the church. The only person that needs to be revived is that person who has a dead spirit.
Yeah.
They need to be made alive to God. And we're the only ones that are going to be able to do it. So we need to man up and woman up, hallelujah, and Jesus up, and just start doing, hallelujah, what God's called us to do.
Yes.
Amen. What he's equipped us for.
Yes.
Believe me, he has the ability to still raise the dead, heal the sick, you know, cast out demons and all of that through every one of us. We just got to do it, that's all. We just got to take the risk. You got to just get out of the boat. You just got to take the step on the water and quit worrying about sinking and what if it doesn't work. Just do it and leave it up to God. He's got broad shoulders. Amen. He can handle it. Amen. We're too timid and worried that, well, if it doesn't happen, they'll think I'm a freak or a flaw. Hey, don't worry about it. It's his responsibility. It's God's responsibility to do the work.
Amen.
Amen. Our responsibility is to rest in what he has said and just step out and take the risk as a human being, amen, that God will show up. Hallelujah. And the more we do it, the more he'll show up. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So, amen. People are coming here and will come here looking for answers, looking for God, looking for hope, looking for love, looking for miracles or whatever. Amen. It won't do them any good to come here if we're all looking for the same thing.
Yeah.
Right. If we haven't found it, there's not any way we're going to direct them to it, right? I mean, there's no way we can point them to the goodness of God and the love of God and the mercy and the grace and the miracle-working power unless we really believe that we have it. Hallelujah.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. Okay, so there you go. That's my personal opinion. Hallelujah. That's Nathan 1:1. That's the whole book, by the way. Praise the Lord. One verse, one chapter. Anyway, let's get into this. Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 8, verses 9 through 13. And we'll talk about the other stuff Sunday. Hallelujah. Not really about that stuff, but just about what we need to be doing. I mean, the enemy's after us. We heard it tonight. We know that. We know he comes and tries to get us into ourselves. Nobody's ever been depressed in Jesus. Can I tell you that?
That's right.
Yep.
I can promise you nobody has. Jesus is not depressing.
No, he's not.
So when we get depressed, and we do. I'm not saying that I never get depressed or that I don't get anxious or whatever. But when I am, it's not Jesus, it's me.
Uh-huh.
I'm not focused on the Lord. I'm focusing too much on myself and on my circumstances and the situations that are ongoing in my life. That is not productive for a Christian. He says we look at things that are not as though they are.
Amen.
We speak to things and they become. We have the nature of God. And the nature of God is faith.
Yes.
It's to say and to see it.
Yes.
Amen. We need to start saying
exactly
what we want to see instead of saying what we're seeing.
Right.
Praise the Lord. If you want things to change, you better start talking different. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, because you've got power. There is power in your tongue. Amen. It's the same power that God has. You can speak to things that are not, and they will change. Those situations and circumstances will change. But you got to talk. You got to open your mouth and release it, and you want it to be in agreement with what this says. That's true for our own personal lives, but it's also true of the lives of the people that we encounter. That's why we want to speak the word to them. May not have to be verbatim, but it has to be at least the principle. You don't need to have every scripture memorized and say, this is in John 1:1. They don't really care what scripture it's in. They just want to hear something that's from the Lord. And Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. And when we speak in agreement with the word of God, our words become spirit and they become alive to people who otherwise are dead and dense and totally deaf to the word of God.
Yes. Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
We need it and they need it. Hallelujah. Yes. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
And I believe God's going to do great things
yes.
in these last days. And our lives are not over.
Right.
It's not done. It's not finished. As long as there's breath in our body, Jesus is still working right here
yes.
on this world. Amen?
Yes.
So we just need to make ourselves available.
Yes.
And like I said, over and over and over, you see in the scripture where the Lord says, paraphrasing, he just says, gut it out here. I mean, man up. Grow up.
Yes.
Be adults.
Yep.
You know, it's time to get past the milk. It's time to move. You know, it's time to start. When you should be teaching, you're still in need of a teacher. That's, you know, what Jesus was saying.
Yeah.
Well, sadly, that's true with us a lot of times. There's not a person in here that cannot teach and preach the word of God.
Right.
Nobody in here. There's no one in here that couldn't do it.
Right.
Amen?
Right.
So, does that mean you're all going to be in a pulpit? I don't know. You're certainly welcome to. You can. But the pulpit is you. You're carrying that pulpit wherever you go. You are in a dais for God. You know, you're in a position to speak to situations and circumstances with authority.
Yes.
And it'll change things. Praise the Lord. So, all right. Hebrews 8, beginning at verse 9. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, for they did not continue in my covenant, and so I showed no concern for them, declares the Lord. You see that? This covenant that he's talking about is not like the covenant that he made with Israel, their fathers, on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. He made a covenant with them, for they did not, but they didn't continue in the covenant, and so I showed no concern for them, declares the Lord. Can you get that in the King James, please?
I just noticed.
Now, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand and led them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. In that, he saith, a covenant. He hath made the first old, now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Let me just back up for a moment and just say that most revivals that have seen and witnessed, even secondhand, like some of the Brownsville and Toronto, were really a mixture of Old Testament and New Testament. I'm not saying God didn't do things, because God did do things. But I'm saying it wasn't pure.
Right.
There was a mixture there. There was a lot of legalism, a lot of all kinds of other things. And, you know, God will still move, you know. He did under the old covenant. But it isn't where I think God's trying to take us to. He wants the real deal. He wants the pure gospel in order for him to be manifest in truth, so that he can be seen as he really is.
Right.
Amen? Now, under the old covenant of law, back to this, it was about the people of Israel that were trying their best to be faithful servants of God. And not to beat a dead horse here, but, you know, most revivals is us Christians crying out for purification so that God will come again. Well, listen, if we're waiting for perfection in terms of human behavior, God's never going to show up.
Right.
No.
Right.
So, you know, we think that, well, okay, we had revival because everybody got their act together.
No.
You know, nobody was doing anything contrary to the Word of God. And so God just, you know, slammed in there. That's just totally impossible. So we need to know that God wants to save the lost, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out demons more than any living human being. No matter how much we want it, God wants to do it more. He wants to be involved in that more than anything else. Praise the Lord. So here was Israel trying their best to be faithful servants. Amen? But eventually God says he turned away from them. Why? Because they couldn't do it. They couldn't keep their end of the bargain. He had a covenant, and the covenant was that you do this, and I'll do this. They didn't do this, so he didn't do that. He said, I'm done. I'm turning my back on you. I'm going to ignore you. Now, we know that he didn't totally do that, but he did withdraw, you might say, the favor or the special blessing that Israel had. Amen? And again, we have this old covenant kind of mentality a lot of times, like God has left. God didn't go anywhere. We don't need to get a bunch of stuff going on to get God to come back because he never left. We just need to open our eyes, amen, and our ears of the Spirit to realize he's here. He's intensely here and wants to do the miraculous, wants to be God Almighty in each and every life. Praise the Lord. So under this new way, everything changed. And now it's about the obedient work of Jesus on the cross and through the resurrection, amen, that God's looking at. Amen? And our spiritual growth comes from what God is already working in us.
Yes.
Amen? To do and to accomplish his purpose. It's the Holy Spirit in us that's doing it. Amen?
Yeah.
Let's look at a couple of scriptures here. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're saying, well, I don't feel like I've grown much, or I'm glad I'm not what I used to be, but I'm not where I want to be. Relax. Because
yeah.
Wherever you are today that you weren't before, you got there because of him. You didn't get there because of you. And wherever you're going, you're going to get there. He's promised it. But he's going to be the one that gets you there. So it's focusing on him. It's staying focused on him and trusting in, again, that finished work. That he that started this work in you, that saved you, is going to take you all the way. He's going to get you to that place of productivity, of fruitfulness, all of that. Amen? That's the desire of God, amen, for your life. Praise God. All right, look at Colossians chapter 2 and verse 19. That's why I'm saying we ought to be the happiest. Even when we're depressed, we ought to be happy. Amen. You know what I'm saying? We can depress about circumstance, but happy that we know the Lord. Hallelujah. This is not going to, it's not going to stay this way. Amen. Yea, though I go through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me. Hallelujah. Even though I'm going through some crap, God is with me. He's holding my hand. He's going to see to it that I get through. He's going to bless me. Amen. This isn't my whole life. It's just where I'm at today. You know, I mean, it's just what we're going through at the moment, right? Praise the Lord. And not holding the head from which all the body by joints and bands having nourishment ministered and knit together increaseth with the increase of God.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We increase with the increase of God. Not us, not ours, but holding not and not holding the head, amen, which is Christ, from which all the body by joints and bands having nourishment ministered and knit together increaseth with the increase of God. Praise the Lord. All right, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Praise the Lord. So even when we're on that faith roller coaster, he is constant. He will not deny himself. Amen. He made a deal. And he made the deal with himself.
Right.
But the deal was about us.
Yeah.
So even if we don't do like the Israelites did, even if we don't live the life we want to live and should everyone try to live, it's okay. Because he's going to abide faithful even when we are unfaithful. He can't do anything else because he's God. He can't deny himself. He is faithful. He's perfect. Amen. He'd have to deny himself. He'd have to undo him, amen, in order to break this covenant that he's made with us. This is awesome. It is good news. It's the thing that everybody under the old covenant dreamed of and hoped for and prayed for, but never got to experience. Praise the Lord. If you ever wondered why things seem so different in the Old Testament, this is why. Same God, different covenant. God hasn't changed. I mean, he wasn't mean and hateful under the old covenant, and now all of a sudden he became really nice and sweet. No, Jesus is the exact image, representation of God. Whatever you see there, that's the God of the Old Testament too, but he was bound by his own covenant with these people.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So in the Old Testament, the Spirit would come on. It would come and go. Amen? Listen to what I'm saying. So when we talk the way we talk Pentecostally, we act as though we're still under the Old Covenant. Like God was here and now he's gone. He came, but we acted up and so he left. No, that's what he did under the old covenant. He'd come, he'd visit on somebody, and then he'd split. Then he'd go away. Amen? He fell on people, and he fell on them for divine acts of service. The prophets of old, Elijah, Elisha, they did great, fantastic miracles. We read them. But God wasn't with them all the time. He'd come when they needed, when he needed to show himself mighty on their behalf or to present something to people of God's true identity, he would fall on them or come on them and they would do this act of service for God. And then he would leave. He wasn't with them all the time. The Spirit came and went. Amen? None of the New Testament writers wrestled with maintaining God's presence. They're not freaking out about God was here last week when we had that real good meeting when Paul was here, but then Timothy showed up and no God. What's up? No. They're all doing it. They're all ministering by the power of the Spirit. Because they knew that's what they were supposed to do. That's what God wanted to do. God had anointed them for that purpose. And every one of us have anointing. You cannot have Jesus and not be anointed. It's just that we don't have an awareness of it or we don't apply it to any given situation, so we don't really get to experience it. Neither does anybody else. That's the sad thing about it. But you have the Spirit always, in without measure. The fullness of the Godhead that was in Jesus is in us now. Same Spirit. Amen. Jesus was operating with the same weapons that we have today. You have been made perfect in Christ, without sin, full of God, full of the Spirit of God. That's the Bible. Hallelujah. So what's the only thing that caused the Spirit of God to depart from Adam and Eve? Sin. Right? The reason God's Spirit withdrew was because of sin. And what's the only thing that caused Jesus to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Sin. Right? Because at that point, he was carrying the sin of the world. Amen? He was on that cross and he was bearing our sin. What's the only thing that would cause the Spirit of God to depart from you today? Sin. But what did Jesus do with our sins? He took them away forever. John 1:29. The The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Now we're talking about John's looking forward to a new covenant. And he's excited because this is the sacrifice we've all been looking for. And he's not just going to cover it. He's taken it away. Praise the Lord. Hebrews 10, verse 14. For by one offering he hath perfected. Everybody say perfected.
Perfected.
By one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Mm-hmm. What is sanctification? It's holiness. It's set apart to God.
Yes.
People say, well, I get it. Grace, we're forgiven. But we need more holiness. You can't get more holy than being sanctified. That's the holiness that God wanted under the old covenant. And it's a gift. It comes by grace.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It's his holiness.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. All right. That's why the Spirit of God will never leave us. Settle it. Get it down deep into you. God is never going to leave you.
Right.
Never. That's the simple, logical, liberating difference of God's new way of grace,
yes,
the new covenant. That is the difference.
Yes.
Permanent relationship.
Amen.
Permanent indwelling of God's presence.
Yes.
God's Spirit. No matter what. And yes, I said no matter what.
Yes.
There are no caveats here. There are no exceptions. No matter what. Even when you commit sins,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
Amen.
He remembers them no more.
That's right.
That's what he said. This isn't my opinion. This isn't me wishing or wanting it to be this way so I could be a complete maniac. I may be, but I couldn't make God do it,
right.
No matter how much I wanted him to.
Right.
It's the way he chose to do it. Praise God. When you've got somebody coming to church looking for answers, they've got addictions, they've got relationship issues, they've got finance issues, they've got it all. I mean, I talked before about the guy that used to come here, he'd come drunk. He was homeless. He lived right up here under the bridge. Thank the Lord, God provided. He got on Social Security. I haven't seen him for several years, at least. But he got into an apartment. Now, I don't know if you know all about his other situation, but I do know what God was doing for him. He really didn't need me to tell him that he should quit drinking. Thou shalt not. You know, I mean, he was already struggling with all of the repercussions and side effects from that.
Right.
People that come that, you know, broken relationship, do they really need to know that they need to be faithful to a husband or a wife? No. They know the other stuff don't work.
Right.
But they're looking for answers.
Right.
They don't need to be told how terrible they are.
Right.
Amen. They need to know how much God loves them. That God's willing to deal. He's already dealt with their sin if they will just give it up and trust him. I don't mean, you know, don't do this and don't do that anymore and then we'll let you be a part of the church. Come with all your crap and God will deal with it.
Yes.
And let him deal with it at his leisure, at his pace. We don't need to be sniffing for cigarette smoke or, you know, checking to see, that smelled like Jim Beam, you know, or whatever, you know. We need to just reach out and tell him God loves you as messed up in all of your mess. God loves you and wants to save you. In fact, he came and died for just you, just in the situation you're in, just like you are. He loved you so much, he couldn't stay away. That's what people need to hear. The things will fall away. The stuff will fall away eventually. Some things take longer than others. Sometimes the addictions are the easiest things to go. It's the anger. It's the hurt. It's the rejection. It's all the other stuff that they'd spend their whole life maybe dealing with.
Yeah.
but God will be with them.
Yes.
He'll be there with them to lead them, to guide them, to help them through, to deal with all of those issues. Amen. That's all of us to some degree in some situation or another. Amen. We all got stuff. So, hallelujah. We've just learned how to roll with the thing a little bit. That's how we roll, I should say, you know. But I mean, we've learned how. I don't mean to cover it up or to be phony. I just mean we've learned that, okay, this too shall pass.
Yes.
That God's going to get us, because we've got some history with God. We know what He's done for us. Yes. We know that He'll be there for us tomorrow. If some bad stuff's going on, it's okay. I don't like it. I'm not enjoying this. But God's still with me. God's going to get me through this too. He that began the good work in me is going to perfect it. It's going to happen. Praise the Lord. World needs to know this. Hallelujah. And so does the church. Hallelujah. Okay, Romans 8, verse 12. We read this in the opening text, but I want to go back and point it out directly here. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors. No, no. Did I say Romans? I meant Hebrews. I just heard my echo of my own voice in my head. Praise the Lord. Hebrews 8, verse 12. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. Praise the Lord. Even when we are totally disobedient, He remains faithful. I'm telling you, this is good news, church. Look. People in the world need to hear this. They need to know that. They need to know that God loves them so much. They don't need to hear, oh, you wretched mess, get down here and get your act together, you know. They need to know in the middle of all of their unfaithfulness, their hostility, God loves them and is willing to wipe away. Now, I'm not saying everybody is saved. I'm saying if they will come and just accept Christ, believe in the death, burial, and resurrection, this is their, amen, their motto. This is their declaration, right? As much as it is ours or anybody else, they need to know that that can be their life. You don't have to come in here with all of this weight of, God, I tried quitting cigarettes so many times. I tried to quit drinking. I tried to quit doing drugs. I tried to, you know, be faithful in relationships. I've tried it. I just fail. Give Jesus a try. Just trust Him. And if you screw up, it'll be all right. He'll be there with you. He'll support you. He'll encourage you. He'll love you. He'll be there for you till you can get your act together. Till you can begin to see some progress. Till you can begin to see things happening in your life. This is what the world needs. And the whole world is not an addict or an alcoholic.
No, that's right.
But they do have the same problems. Amen. Just not that one.
Right.
You know, because a lot of people out there, they think, well, I don't need Jesus. I've never had a drinking problem. I've never cheated on my wife. I never did drugs. Well, you poor sap. You'd be better off if you had. Because at least then you'd know you need a Savior, right?
Yeah.
Then you'd know I got to have Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. The Holy Spirit is sealed within us.
Yes.
Sealed. Forever.
Yes.
Ephesians 1, verses 13 and 14. It sounds too good to be true. Because it's too good for this world.
Yes.
But it's true. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise,
yes,
which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession, which is our bodies, amen, unto the praise of His glory. The Holy Spirit in our spirit is the earnest. It's the saying, I'm coming back for your body.
Yeah.
You know, you pay earnest money when you buy things, a house or a car. Or sometimes you have to put up some earnest money to show that you're serious, right?
Yeah.
That I'm coming back. You know, that I'm going to buy this. I'm going to purchase this. I'm going to do this. That's what He's talking about. The Holy Spirit is the earnest.
Yes.
It's the proof that God is coming back for us.
Yes.
Amen. I've purchased them. I'm coming back. I'll be back and I'll come and get them. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit is the promise.
Yes.
It's the guarantee.
Yes.
So he's never going anywhere. He's never going to leave us. Amen? Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 5. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have, for he hath said, I will never leave you or forsake you. Does that mean that we shouldn't believe that God wants us to prosper, or that God wants to bless us with houses we didn't build, vineyards that we didn't plant? No. But don't freak out because of where you are at the moment. He's not going anywhere. And wherever God is, there's abundance. Exceeding abundantly above all. So he's just saying, trust me. I'm not forsaking you. I'm not leaving you in the situation you're in. I'm going to be with you. And because I'm with you, my favor is with you, and anything is possible. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, we get into these conflicts because you say, well, you know, you don't believe the Old Testament? Of course I do. The entire Bible is inspired. The Holy Spirit, God, inspired the writers of the Holy Scriptures. So the whole Bible, Genesis to Revelation, is inspired. But there's a lot of debate about law and grace. Yes. Should we adopt some of the law? I mean, you know, after all, it's all over the Old Testament there. Don't we need a balance, you know, to keep people from going completely crazy? Right? I mean, too much grace and they'll just go nuts, you know. We need a balance. No, because in the New Testament they talked about new wine in old wineskins.
Right.
He said there's not a balance, it's a mixture.
Right.
And God abhorred it. Because
right.
That covenant is over.
Yes.
Right.
Amen? The truth is, 99%, probably even higher than that, of people that are debating this issue of law and grace are Gentiles, who, by the way, were never given the law in the first place. But they're fighting for it today. But they were never under it. It was never part of them. So for us, it's the new covenant or it's nothing at all, unless you want to convert to Judaism. Praise the Lord. So let's enjoy everything from Genesis to Revelation. Knowing that it's all inspired, but let's also, with that knowledge, recognize that there's a surprise ending to the story. The cross, the resurrection. And that surprise ending inspires us to go back and reinterpret the beginning of the story in the light of all that has now been revealed to us. Not that it isn't true, it's just that we've looked at it through legal lenses instead of grace.
Yeah.
We've looked at God through the eyes of this covenant that he had with Israel instead of the God who always wanted to have grace. If you don't believe that, look at his relationship with Abraham. He said, he's my friend. Because it was before the law. He never put demands on him. And when he did, say, don't go to Egypt, don't do this, don't. And Abraham did it anyway.
Yeah.
Right.
And God then called him a prophet.
Right.
After he gave his wife away, knowing this was not a good thing. This wasn't, you know, like just she's going to go, you know, cook for the guy.
Right.
This was about making babies. I mean, that was the idea in the first place.
Right.
And Abram says, tell him you're my sister, not my wife, because could be costly to me. The guy finds out, he said, God said, I was going to kill you. And the Pharaoh said, what, me? I didn't do anything. And God said, it's a good thing you didn't.
Yeah.
Or you'd be dead.
Right.
He said, you need to ask my prophet to pray for you. Mm-hmm. Oh, you mean the guy that just pimped his wife to me?
Yeah.
This is before the law.
Yeah.
God had already declared this guy's going to be the father of a multitude.
Yes.
And God had already made promises, and God had already declared it, and God already knew what he was going to do before he did it. But he still called him his prophet and said, he's got power with me. You need to have him pray for you. The guy's thinking, I didn't do anything. This guy's been lying and sneaking and cheating, and he's the prophet? He's my friend. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So look at the old covenant that's now obsolete. And look at it through the lens of the New Testament, the new covenant, and rest in that finished work. Amen. Let me finish with this. John chapter 10, verses 28 and 29. And we'll close with this. We need the whole Bible. We need the entire Word of God. But we need it based on the truth. God's not trying to take us backwards to something. He's always moving forward. Hallelujah. So here's what John said. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all. And no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Amen. You aren't going anywhere. God has the God grip on you, and he ain't letting go. He said, they're mine, and I'm not letting them go, and nobody's going to take them. Amen. You are secure in Jesus, and we need to live our lives out of that security. That's what motivates other people. That's what causes other people to look at us, as Tim was saying, and say, what's going on? Yeah. I mean, I see you've got issues. I see you've got some struggles, but how is it you seem to always have expectations of something better, or you always seem to be hopeful, and you always seem to be upbeat? Why? Because I know who holds and he's not letting go, and it's going to be all right. Yes. Amen. He's going to take care of me. He's going to provide for me, for my family. Yes. Amen. We think about our children, grandchildren. They're all born into sin. Right. Amen. They got to be saved.
Right.
They got to come to know Jesus.
Yes.
The beauty of it is, he talks about the unsanctified husband, if you're married to somebody and you get saved, and then they're not saved, and so they're an unbeliever, that they become sanctified because of you. Mm-hmm. Sanctified just simply means God shows them favor that he wouldn't otherwise show them. Our children are the same way. Because of the parents, our children are sanctified. It means that God can reach them where he might not reach them if they were not saved, or if they were not in a household that had saved parents. Amen? We have promises from God. We and our house will be saved. We need to declare that. We need to say it every day. I don't care who it is. Our brothers, our sisters, our children, our grandchildren, they're going to be saved. If they're not saved today, they're going to be before they get out of here. Right? Because God's going to honor us by reaching them. Hallelujah. He's going to show us favor, even for our loved ones. Doesn't mean we just, you know, kick up our heels and say, well, whatever, you know, happens, happens. No, I mean, we've got a responsibility to reach out to them, to share what God does in our lives and what God wants to do in their life, of course. But it's still God that does the saving.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
He's promised to never leave us or forsake us. You're in good hands with Almighty God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Don't leave home without him. Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. I might even say, you can't leave home without him. Praise the Lord. He's going wherever you go. Glory to God. Amen. Everybody have a great rest of the week. The Lord bless you and let his face shine upon you and continue to bless you in every area. And we'll look forward to seeing you back here Sunday and see what God's going to do. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.